I chose the title of the exhibition, A World Not Ours, because I believe it perfectly encapsulates the problem that has become the refugee crisis nowadays. First of all, I should say it's borrowed from the title of a film by the Palestinian director Mahdi Fleifel. And this film is a portrait of three generations of refugees, Palestinian refugees, who live in South Lebanon in a refugee camp that was set up in 1948 called Ain El Helwe. I think the title is very telling in relation to the condition of being a refugee and the idea of leaving a place, going to another place and being received. And if you consider the conditions under which people in Syria, Afghanistan, or the Middle East in general leave, the fact that, for example, that they are leaving a world that is no longer theirs because this world has been transformed beyond belief. But they are also coming to a world that is not theirs because they're coming to a foreign place and they're received as foreigners. So this title, for me, has this kind of double meaning of like arrival, reception, and alienation. I took three things into consideration. One is, of course, the location. And I think it's really important for exhibitions that take place in non-metropolitan, non-cosmopolitan or peripheral areas to be relevant for the local community and to speak about a subject that is recognizable to them. And that's why I decided to work with the refugee crisis and by extent the concept of the question rather of forced migration, diaspora and exile. The second thing was that I also took into account the mission statement of the foundation, and this mission has to do with addressing very specific geopolitical and social realities in this particular part of the world, which is a frontier between Asia and Europe. And the third is that, of course, the refugee crisis has been so pronounced in terms of how it has influenced local society here, both economically, both socially, but I think also existentially. And to be quite honest, I couldn't conceive of anything else other than this exhibition. And finally, I also chose to work with this subject because I think it's actually become a fundamental existential issue for Europe. A lot of the political polarities that are now being played out in many European countries have as their root this question of the refugee and the status of a person who is an asylum seeker or a foreigner or someone who is, as most people do, trying to find a better life in a continent which is not necessarily always welcoming. Speaking of this before and after and the understanding of what drives someone to embark on this very perilous journey, I think I should mention the work of Tania Boukal, because Tania was one of the artists invited by the foundation to produce new work, and she spent quite a lot of time here in Samos, but also across in Turkey, traveling to various locations that are locations for smugglers. And she's looked at the economy of underlying the smuggling industry, and of course in turn connected that to how different the tourist trajectory is between, let's say, Kusadasi and Samos, and how different it is if you go on a tourist boat or you go as a refugee. Róza El-Hassan, who is of Syrian origin and has also worked with refugees and with NGOs and charitable organizations, she is looking into the idea of shelter, as these people need to live somewhere, and linking that to her ongoing interest in ecological architecture. So she's revisited a very ancient Syrian building technique and built an adobe house, which is a kind of beehive-shaped house, which is made out of mud and straw, which can be built very easily, very cheaply, and very collaboratively, and also produces no pollution. The New York-based architectural firm Diller, Scofidio and Renfro is presenting a video called Exit in collaboration with Laura Kurgan and other artists, architects, sociologists, researchers and statisticians. And this video is a study into global migration patterns from 2008 until today. And this work is very, very important for me because it somehow contextualizes the refugee crisis and this increasing condition of nomadism, because in 20 years it's estimated that about 1 billion people will be in exile or in forced migration. And it puts that into a more global picture. There's also the rap duo Juice Rap News from Australia, and they're presenting a video from their internet TV show, which is a news program about very, very contested hot topics in the media. So from terrorism to immigrants, which is the episode that is being presented here.
Newsflash! Humans are migrating en masse. Many in search of work and better circumstance. Many more displaced by wars and massacres. Predatory trade pacts, ethnic clashes, historical fractures, climate change impacts. Some call them refugees, others illegal immigrants. Whatever the label, there are more displaced people today than ever in history. Collectively, they form one of the world's largest nations, a flagless country of tens of millions, half of them children. So how is the world handling this crisis today? Surely the wisest, richest societies are responding in enlightened ways. We now invite three guests from such countries. First up, business magnate, presidential candidate Donald Trump.
My fellow Americans, our great nation's become a rotten dump. Thanks to the communist Obama Trump, our southern border is an open door for any Juan to come. Illegals are pouring through the country, scooping all the dollars up.
And what is interesting about this project, which is a project of Hugo Farrant, who's a rapper, and Giordano Nani, who is a historian, and it's satire and comedy and performance and theater, is the fact that, unlike other news media, brings together conflicting opinions and plays these conflicting opinions off against each other to also pinpoint the problematic. So various characters appear in the film, like Donald Trump and Julian Assange, people from the extreme left or people from the extreme right. And these opinions are actually played off against each other, with the fictional personality of Robert Frost, who is the one who is mediating the dialogue and, of course, making all the critique about xenophobia, racism, and all these problems. Yannis Behrakis is a Greek photojournalist who has worked on the issue of the refugee crisis for 25 years, visiting many, many locations in the world where such a thing has happened. And this year he also won the Pulitzer Prize, him and his group, as he's also representing Reuters. He was one of the people that made known to the international public the refugee crisis that broke out here in Samos, on Lesbos, and on other Greek islands that have been closest to the coast of Turkey. In this exhibition, he's presenting works from these islands, but also from Idomeni in the north of Greece and Piraeus. And it was very important for me to include Yannis, because apart from the fact that he's showing work that is really riveting, I think, emotionally, and goes beyond standardized journalistic representation, he himself is very engaged in the issue of the refugee crisis, and also does charitable work. And his work is shown, this was, I think, a really important decision, it was not shown as printed photographs, because it's work that appears in the media, in the news, on the internet. So we have a slide projection and a table with selected clippings where his work has been published, because I felt that this was more true to the medium. So in terms of artists who we had the chance to have with us here in Samos for the opening, there's Ninar, Esber, who made one new performance work and also showed an existing work. Tania Boukal, who showed mostly new work. Marina Gioti was here, Giorgos Moutafis was here, and of course Sallie, Latch, who created this incredible series of interviews with refugees here on the island of Samos.
With the Blind Lighthouse, I wanted to talk about the relationship between immigrants and what they are what they are attracted to, that is Europe, let's say. It is like a lighthouse that is that cannot guide people, because the feminine figure is blind, so she cannot guide people in the sea, let's say. Plus, the more people approach and started seeing her from close, they discover that she's like a monster. So for me, it's like the attraction people have to Europe. They see it as Eden. It's paradise. It's where all the dreams will come true. And they are ready to risk their lives to come to this continent. But this continent first is not really ready to welcome them, or doesn't know how to do. Second, they discover once they arrive that there's no place, I want to say, no place called home or heaven, or it's only a fantasy. All my art is trying to find a home or another home or another place to be and to live. So for me, there's no place better than the other.
I wanted to do the interview here because the whole project started for me in a way with the photos of the kids I saw in January, who were drowned and were laying on the beach. And somehow it also ends here, because the last thing that happens to these people is that they are buried here, not knowing what their future could have been. So in a way, for me, the whole thing of coming here, and I visit the place quite often, I was here like every second day, because for me it's a place that says a lot about the whole project and what the whole work I did here. It's something I have to do. It's something I'm not thinking about. Is it activism? Is it art? What is it? Is it the truth? It's not important for me. It's just things I need to do. And I don't think I can change the world with that. It's just the kind of offer to give people the opportunity to see things. Maybe also to see things through my eyes, because it's not the eyes of the refugees. It's just what I see, what I'm thinking about it.
Η εικόνα αυτή είναι η ροκ μίλιο της οικογένειας.
Αυτή ήρθε από τη
Έχει
μικρά...
Έχει μεγάλη συναισθηματική αξία.
Ακούς, από τη Μικρά Ασία ήρθε αυτή.
Ναι, μαμά, από τη Μικρά Ασία ήρθε. Η γιαγιά την έφερε.
Έκανε η Σοφία.
Με τα κόπων και βασάνων. Είναι ό,τι περιέσωσε.
Ένα κορίτσι και ήτανε Μαρίνα. Την έφερε σε αυτήν, ναι. Την άφησε από το σώμα της. Και ήρθε εδώ.
Το έργο που παρουσιάζω στην έκθεση είναι ένα κομμάτι οικογενειακής ιστορίας. Αποτελείται από δύο συνεντεύξεις και μία που προέκυψε, τρεις δηλαδή, συνεντεύξεις ανθρώπων της οικογένειάς μου, και αφορά ένα αντικείμενο που προέρχεται από τη Μικρά Ασία. Η γιαγιά μου και ο παππούς μου αναγκάστηκαν το 22 να έρθουν πρόσφυγες στην Ελλάδα. Και κουβάλισαν μαζί τους μια εικόνα της Αγίας Μαρίνας, μαζί και άλλα τιμαλφή τα οποία εξαφανίστηκαν, με αποτέλεσμα η εικόνα αυτή να είναι το τελευταίο πράγμα που έχει απομείνει στην οικογένεια από εκείνα τα χρόνια. Θεωρώ ότι έχει κάτι να προσφέρει μια διάσταση σε αυτή την έκθεση, η οποία ασχολείται με το τώρα κυρίως. Η διάσταση αυτή είναι η παγκοσμιότητα μάλλον και η διαχρονικότητα του τι σημαίνει μετακίνηση σε αυτόν τον πλανήτη. Μπορεί να έχει τύχει να έχουμε ζήσει σε ειρηνικές εποχές, η γενιά μας, αλλά οι ίδιοι προερχόμαστε από μετακίνηση πληθυσμών. Ειδικά στη Μεσόγειο είναι ένα θέμα που επανέρχεται συνεχώς.
Καταρχήν θέλω να σου πω ότι η Κατερίνα Γκρέκο βρήκε ένα πολύ όμορφο τρόπο για να κάνει διάλογο με τους ντόπιους, επιλέγοντας τις συγκεκριμένες δουλειές, που δεν είναι, ας πούμε, δουλειές που βλέπουμε στις τηλεοράσεις και στα περιοδικά. Και έχει ξεκινήσει έναν άλλο διάλογο, καταρχήν πρώτα μεταξύ της ίδιας με εμάς, μεταξύ εμάς των, ας πούμε, καλλιτεχνών φωτογράφων, και μεταξύ του φεστιβάλ με τον κόσμο. Δεν δείχνει καταρχήν κάτι έτσι αρνητικό. Οι δουλειές είναι ιδιαίτερες, δεν σου δείχνουν κάτι ομά, απλά μπαίνεις σε μια διαδικασία να πας πιο κοντά. Για παράδειγμα, η συγκεκριμένη δουλειά μου είναι κάτι μικρά τυπωματάκια που σε καλεί πιο κοντά, σαν να σου λέω, έλα πιο κοντά μου, θέλω να σου πω κάτι, θέλεις να δεις κάτι. Αλλά όσο πιο κοντά πας σε αυτές τις εικόνες, θα δεις πράγματα που σε μια δεύτερη ανάγνωση ίσως να μην τα έχεις σκεφτεί. Ίσως να δεις, ας πούμε, ανθρώπους που θρηνούν, ανθρώπους που είναι σε μια αλφα κατάσταση, όπως ας πούμε μέσα σε ένα δράμα, δηλαδή να κλαίει ένας άντρας πάνω από το νεκρό σώμα μιας γυναίκας του, αλλά και ανθρώπους χαρούμενους που φυλάνε τη γη και λένε Europa, Europa. Έτσι είναι και ο τίτλος του συγκεκριμένου project, Europa, Europa.
So my coming here has put me really like my nose up against the wall of power that is so impenetrable. I feel that way. And I feel that the only thing that might save all of us is if we all work in solidarity together to do our little bit. In my case, it's doing interviews and hoping that my interviews can help with the real life stories, with the human stories, and that this will make a difference in some way to mobilize people so that people will organize, work in solidarity, and make a difference, make a change.
I try to stay true to my own trajectory as a curator working on socially and politically engaged issues. I'm really interested in narrative and the notion of testimony. This is something very important for me. Also historical context. So these are the two things that you'll find as a kind of subtext or as a grounding in the show. And the other thing that I'm always interested in building up in terms of like curatorial strategy is the notion of complementarity, of complementing stories, histories, narratives, and of unearthing also marginalized narratives, narratives that don't make it to the mainstream media. In working more and more with the artists and in reading more and more about this subject, I started realizing, of course, that, you know, it's not a black and white question. I think we're talking about a gray zone. And one of the things that I really wanted the show to engender is a sense of empathy. There's only one thing that brings progress. It's actually three things: education, education, and education. And in this sense, given the fact that we are in a peripheral location, the education program that has been developed, and of course the tourist program that the curatorial fellows are developing, are equally as important as the exhibition itself. And the mediation of this exhibition, I think, is of paramount importance in order to be able to reach a public that is not necessarily accustomed to the language of contemporary art. But through works that I have tried to remain accessible.